I'm Iain Dowie, and this is my trip down Sheepfoot Lane.
I'm Paul Murray, and this is my trip down Sheepfoot Lane.
I'm Martin Ogden, and this is my trip down Sheepfoot Lane.
Vernon, Paul Murray picks it up here, and Murray will strike, and Murray scores! Paul Murray for Latics, what a goal! Seconds gone on the foot.
That's it, 4-0 the final score. And a playoff place for Oldham Athletic.
Iain, we'll kick off with you because it's all about the Wadsworth stroke Dowie era. You were promoted to manager and you was around just over 18 months, wasn't you? But you certainly made your mark.
Yeah, I mean, listen, the way it arrived was a very strange scenario. It didn't sit well with me in lots of ways and still doesn't to this day. I mean, I got a call from Harry Redknapp wanting to take me to Portsmouth as his assistant manager. And I told Mick. Mick said, yeah, no problem, he had with my blessing. And then all of a sudden, the chairman didn't want me to go. And then Mick, you know, so I said to Mick, bloody hell, what's happening here? In the end, Mick had a big row with the chairman and they ended up parting company. But Mick had said to me, listen, he's not going to let you go unless they pay up the contract, which at the time they weren't going to do. So it wasn't about the money, it's more about just the way it was. So it was a sad way, you know, but I'll be always grateful for working alongside Mick. You know, I learned a lot from him. I was a different person than him I went about it in a different fashion, but he certainly helped me in the early period in them times. And then, so, you know, when it comes so quick on your toes that you've got a job, you know, I was blessed with a brilliant dressing room that I just think just needed a bit of structure, a bit of organisation.
It was a very talented dressing room, wasn't it, Tim?
Oh, well, listen, some incredibly talented people. But I think, you know, when we've got one of the lads, at the heartbeat of that team, we had fantastic energy, and Muzza was right at the heart of that in terms of what he could do, his athletic ability. You know, we took some gambles, you know. A lot of people didn't believe in Les Pogliacomi. I did. I took Fitz for non-league, was the risk. I took Wayne Andrews. You know, I wanted to play John Sheridan. I want to play three at the back. I just seen that and letting John drop in. You know, it worked very well. You know, you think about Lee Duxbury, leaders, John Sheridan, Lee Duxbury, Darren Sheridan, you know, just to name a few. Stuart Barmer, some of them. You know, good pros who do the right thing. And then we had some attacking talent, David Eyres, outstanding player. So, you know what I mean? But, you know, what I've always felt was, you have to be, I think, you have to let John do what John does, John Sheridan, because he was that good. I'm not being rude. He was as good as, even his knee was shot. David Eyres was special. We ended up getting Josh Lowe doing what he could do. And then, you know, and then we really need to finish off was in front of goal. So, you know, we had some players who were certainly outstanding. You know, I think young lads like Armstrong coming through, and yeah, you know, it worked very well. David Harrell. There's loads. You know, Fitz Hall, you know, Clint Hill.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's a lot of good, when I look at that. You know, and to be fair, the manner of it is, looking down the list, I never fell out with, I had one falling out with Carlo, and that was my fault, not his. And I apologised to him in the morning, as far as I know, he's in the dressing room. Other than that, we had one or two little moments with some of the senior pros when a few drinks were involved. But other than that, we were good lads who wanted to work hard and wanted to, you know, win games. And you know, I look at that 2002-2003 season, not to lose two games back-to-back, you know, and maybe I was at 7-8 wins in one stage in a row. You know, that's a mark of a really good team. They were fit, and they were fit.
They was, because you had John Arbin there, didn't you, Iain?
Yeah, well, listen, John. I was talking to John. Don't forget, was the Oldham fitness lad for the rugby league team, and he was just talking to me one day, and I said, listen, I've always had a thing about getting lads in the pool and bits and pieces. He said, we do a lot of, it's always part of it. And I said, well, listen, I said, given what would you come and, you know, listen, I'm going to do the fitness in terms of on the pitch, because I'm going to do a lot of training. But, you know, a little bit of structure and about the warm-ups and all that is something, you know, it'd be great. And, you know, we had Tony there that allowed me to Tony to do the nice things, you know, five sides and bits and pieces. Although Tony was really knowledgeable too. So it was a really good team, us three. And John said, yeah, he'd come. And look, tantamount to what John did is he did his warm-up with the ball. I never seen the same warm-up ever in the time I was there. And he's a good lad. Could take you on if you wanted to take you on. You know, you wouldn't want to mess with him.
There was boxing as well, wasn't there?
Yeah, well, we used to, I think Ricky Hatton used that gym up at the top there, which we lads loved, you know. Gosh, yeah. I mean, I think I had a later incident with Calvin Zola. I hit him on the nose by mistake. He was sparring. But, you know, he John, we used to do that skipping weights and the bag work. It was brilliant. The lads loved it. And I just think what we brought was a lot of variety to the training. Because part of what my, I suppose, gender, well, part of what the very soul of what I did is I wanted to work hard on the training ground. So my sessions were very intense. So John, I found a way then to maybe get that recovery into their legs, even though you're working as hard as they were. You know, he was clever at, very clever at making that recovery doable. I mean, we looked at food and everything, and it worked very well. You know, we took amino acids and bits and pieces, but the swimming was a big part of the recovery. And John's fitness work was outstanding. There's no doubt. I mean, that's why I never played under or met in my time a better fitness condition than him.
I remember he introduced like a log, didn't he? A proper booklet, which I actually printed. That they kept daily with all the movements on them. They had to fill it in, hadn't they?
Yeah.
After training, it was absolutely immense.
The true thing is that when I look back then, I don't think anyone had a training program for the week. We had it every week, and it changed every week. The lads knew where they were. And then John was very good at going to Muzza, for example. I'm using Muzza here, saying, right, Paul, what you are, and for the fitness side, what do you need from me? What you want, and specialise little bits of work from others to do it. You know, I would do that with the football. I was a great believer in individual work. I think you have to do individual work with players, and, you know, and it's difficult with those. But John was very clever at doing that, going to Muzza and just picking out little bits and pieces. Good listener. I mean, he taught me a lot about listening to players, and I became much better at it rather than just being in transmit mode. It was a really good team. And Tony was really good for me. I had a lot of faith in him. He was an excellent coach. Was great with the kids. Knew all about the kids in depth. And, you know, in the second season, that was very important given what happened with Chris Moore and bits and pieces. But so, we had a good team and a lot of very, very, very good players. And listen, you know, structure and organisation, a bit of way we play, a different system. You know, you can take credit for that in the end.
I'll add to that, right? What I will say is, right, so they were really good years, but the thing was about it all, they were all good people. So from the staff all the way through the players, no one had an ego. You talk about Shez, they were just like, you know, and Shez is one of the best players I've ever played with, but no one had any egos, and if there was a slight tinge of it, it got beaten out of them. So it was the people you were working with. I remember everyone was just really top notch in terms of people. You know, when I look back, and that was part of, I think, why we were so successful. And everything got thrown at us, the swimming, the boxing, because we were good people, wanted to learn more. We just all accepted it, and it, you know, it panned out really well. But,
well, I've got a question here for you. I'll go back to Iain after with his. And there's a couple of questions, and it said, you talk about having been the main man who single-handedly kept Oldham up the following season. Who do you believe was the main man? Well, obviously, you believe it was you, don't you?
I don't know where that come from, to be honest.
But it's actually called Jonathan Nesbitt.
Oh, well, I don't know where he's got that from. But
absolute cracking question.
looking back at that particular season, obviously Iain had left. I'd come down to Palace to have a chat and, and probably, listen, it is what it is. I'm sort of pretty loyal. I'd already made the decision to go to Portugal. And I think with Simon at the time, I said, look, I'm not going, I'm staying. And I wasn't really well known for my goals, but I think I ended up scoring 6 in the last 9 games. And, there was...
You actually scored 2 in 1.
Wickham. But, I think that's where it's coming from, that season under Brian. Towards the end, we were struggling. I think we needed 11 points from the last, I don't know how many games, and I ended up scoring a few, so maybe people thought I did save that season. When Iain left, it was obviously slight changes and that, but, I enjoyed my time thoroughly there, Roy, times.
You would do. Iain, the same guy, Mr. Nesbitt, is saying, do you think we underachieved with the amount of money we spent that season?
I don't know what amount of money we spent. It wasn't a lot, given the
value. Well, the fans seem to think you spent a lot, but I mean, I wouldn't know neither. Know about the 20 grand to Fitz all.
Yeah, well,
I mean, well spent money.
Yeah, well, listen, my view is, in terms of the players, I wanted to progress, and push the team on, to get where we got to. And, well, if we compare budgets with QPR, we wouldn't have been a quarter of theirs unless we played in the playoffs. So, listen, you all have a view of it. I don't have a picture of... I don't remember spending a whole load of money. They in terms of that, we were very cute in what we brought in. Josh Lowe, Fitz and Wayne gave us something we didn't have in terms of energy. Fitz was phenomenal. It's what it is. I felt this just needed tinkering with. We didn't need a lot. As Pazmaza said, there's a lot of good people there. You get the likes of, John Sheridan, as I say, good people, Lee Duxbury, Darren Sheridan, they're men in and around the place. David Eyres, they're men. They're good men. And as a result, the dressing room is a well-run place.
Yeah, it was. Well, a question from me then, because somebody said, well, he liked that question. I said, well, if your chairman walks out on you two months before the season finishes, do you think that we might have done better in those playoffs?
Well, listen, I don't, in the end, I look at the results, and I was looking at it the other day. We didn't lose a lot. From 10 games out, we were quiet. We lost the odd one, but I mean, we were decent. We lost at Wigan once, 3-1. Other than that, and they were better than us. That's the fact. Other than that, we didn't lose an awful lot. So I don't really think that. I mean, listen, I was party to that. And I in the summer was the worst because I was on holiday and I received a call from Fitz in particular telling me that the chairman had sold him to Southampton. So, you know what I mean? and had sold him. So he didn't come. It wasn't, a lot of them underhand deals were done when I was away on holiday. And, that was a bit of pill to swallow. And then obviously the takeover and X, Y, and Z. So, I think some of the players didn't get their bonuses from getting into the playoffs and bits and bits. I know that I had a bonus in my contract that I never received that was sizable at the time for Oldham. So I end up back. So in the end, it was a new regime. So, but I felt, listen, he was ever at the heart of what we did anyway, and that's not being cruel.
From a player's point of view, I wouldn't agree. It made no difference whatsoever,
didn't it?
No.
That's fair enough.
Our culture at the club. We were a football club. Roy, and it sounds like that. Too often, I think managers get dragged into doing politics. And in the end, I couldn't cope. You couldn't change what was happening, what you want to do. To be fair, he wasn't one of them ranting and raving about if he lost results. I mean, he wanted success, and he was getting success. And in the end, he did what he did. And it's the rest is history. But
I was talking.
The players were. My job was to manage the players, and the players were easy to manage, very easy to manage. And very performed as much as I couldn't have asked any more from. And even the season after, you know, the time I was there, couldn't have asked any more to Keown. That we took, I believe, might have been Martin, probably know better than me, maybe 16, 10 or 12, 16, 17 year olds away at the start of the to Northern Ireland, I think, something like that, maybe less, but anyway.
What people don't realise, Iain, is that we went on the pre-season to Belfast in last year's training kit. We didn't have any new kit. But, you know, everyone bonded, got on with it and had a great few days.
And I remember we used to do the players' dinner and bits and pieces. We used to cook and go and shop and bits and pieces. And, you know, Lil and all them players, the girl who used to do the food and good characters, a lot of good people around the ground, you know, ground. And as Paul says, even from top to bottom, the staff in and around the ground were amazing, as were the players. Like, you know, I can't remember, and I don't know, having to really rip a strip off a player. And as I say, Muzzle was there when I probably stepped over the line with Carlo a little bit, and I apologised the next day. But other than that, and by the way, Carlo was right and I was wrong. It was what it was. And he's an outstanding player for me, Carlo. That era, dressing rooms were turbulent places. I don't really, ours wasn't. It wasn't turbulent. It was well run. I dipped in and out. I had a great relationship with every player that I was looking at. There's not one I really didn't, you know, there was a couple that I wanted a bit more from, but most of them I couldn't ask for any more from at any time in my time there.
I think we did up a little bit, Martin.
Just tell us a little bit about yourself. 23 years at Boundary Park, in all sorts of capacities, carrying big teapots and all things like that.
Yeah, and then when Soss and Ronnie Evans left, Iain came in and basically ended up doing the kit as a part-time. I had a full-time job with a well-known telecommunications company.
Climbing telegraph poles, was you?
Not a lot, but yeah. And when we had a season there in them days, I just booked the Fridays as annual leave, the Tuesdays as annual leave. I think we had 17, that season we did 17 away games on the trot without getting beat. Had to go and buy the food in the morning, the ready-made meals, coming home. I used to cook them with fluffy rice. The curry always had fluffy rice. and introduce the lads to, I don't know if you recognise this, you two.
Yeah.
We had Phoenix Knights going on the coach. And also I was in charge of the music as well. Not to everybody's taste, but...
I've got to say, it's very much for my taste. I've got to say that. Let me, you know, I don't want to go, because he's on the call to embarrass him, but Mark, he was an outstanding kit man. The diligence, the attention to detail. I seen the military operation. I wanted it to be, didn't have to mess about, you know, on game day, you want everything to run smoothly, and everything runs smoothly, even for the food. But the music he played on the coach, some didn't. I loved it, so it was brilliant for me. So, listen, he never was nothing but a smile on his face. You know, I don't think we ever had a crossword, and maybe, I'm sure I've been in a bad mood once or twice and said some things. But anyway, my view is when you're angry and you lose and say things. But he was, some lads adored him. Everyone around the place adored him. He's a special person who had it at Oldham very much at his heart.
Once, Gaffer, it was the first morning in Belfast at the hotel. I'd not done a pre-season tour, so I was down early for breakfast. And it was me and the fish, and I said, oh, I'll have an omelette, I think. Of course, I took it into an omelette, and the lads have to come down and have toast and cereal. And I go, what are you eating there? So I never had the omelette after that.
Listen, even that, I remember the pre-season. Do you remember being in the back of the...
I was going to tell the tale there, Roy.
It's a good tale.
We had about 5 days in Belfast. Of course, Iain had a lot of connections with his international career. And we trained out, and it was either the Tuesday or the Wednesday. He said, right, we're training hard this morning. We're coming back to the hotel for lunch, and then we've got an afternoon. I'm going to give you a tour of Belfast. 2 o'clock at the front door.
So everyone's troops down and tracksuits, 2 o'clock, expecting the coach to turn up. And all of a sudden, there's about 5 of these white armoured Land Rovers with the police with the machine guns turn up, and they were for us. And he said, so you got about 6 people in the back of each Land Rover. So we got in the back, and then they were great, the police, like, right, don't worry if the bricks start raining in, but armoured plated. And we went all round the Falls Road, and you'd have never done it. And
listen, you couldn't do it now. They'd get a rip. I mean, the lads who took us were amazing, but you could not do that. I mean, looking back, that was crazy. But it was brilliant. The lads, it's just in the face when these bricks started hitting the Land Rovers. It was
the next morning, I thought, oh, great, we can go training. After John had had them in the pool at 7 o'clock in the morning, like Iain said, John was ahead of his time. I mean, I'm a rugby league fanatic, and John was a rugby league background. And we got the bananas and jelly babies. And this was 2002. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure John and Iain were ahead of the game in those days. The pre-season meal, pre-match meal was chicken and broccoli, wasn't it, Muzza? Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
you know, and things up to it. But everyone worked hard. But on those coach trips back from London, we had a coach driver, didn't we, Iain?
Yeah.
Make the coach driver.
Two chevrons.
Two chevrons. Oh yeah. Always got to. We nearly had a nasty accident on the roundabout going to. What's the hotel at High Wycombe? At Burnham Beaches.
Burnham Beaches.
Yeah. But he had, was it 4 1/4 hours? He could only drive for 4 1/4 hours. So,
by the way, he was never driving 4 hours 16 minutes either. Trust me. No. I mean, listen, he's a good lad. Very dry. It was funny.
Oh yeah.
But it's funny that on the Saturday morning away at the hotel, Mick had come down and he'd have the biggest breakfast you've ever seen, because that was him till the afternoon. But he's the smartest dressed coach driver you've ever seen, because he used to get changed and with his 3-piece suit on, and Alan and the directors, he was in the director's box, wasn't it, Mick? Yeah. But it was good. I just had to keep feeding him coffee, black coffee on the front seat, while Muzza and Ayres, he was sat behind giving him some terrible stick.
Oh, he was brilliant. We used to get, because he used to have that little lisp, didn't he? So we used to get him to say some phrases. Oh, God, anything with S's in.
Yeah. Carrow Road.
Yeah, or ours.
But there was some. It was a brilliant season, really. It's just a pity we couldn't get to that final hurdle. We should have done with QPR, but we had some brilliant trips that season, didn't we?
Yeah.
Iain, another question for you from the same guy. Do you think there are players in the non-league today like the ones you signed that season?
Yeah, I do. What? I do, very much so. I think it's a case of spotting the talent, looking at it, and giving a chance. You know, my view is there's plenty of lads who just need. I've always thought, probably at lower level, and it does sadden me to see where Oldham are and the level they're at the moment. You know, but at that lower level, if you took the lads from the, you know, I don't know, the Championship down, I'm thinking about, you know, even some of the Premier League guys, young lads, and work with them. You know, there's a way of doing that, I think. I think you recover an awful lot of them. I also think it's exactly the same. If you see a good young one in non-league, if you work with them, you've got to spend time working with them. But, my view is, I think there's amazing talent to be had. I mean, I'm not being funny. Chris Smalling's the best one, because we just talked about him and everyone seems to deride him. He's now doing brilliantly out in Roma, and people are talking about he may be getting back. You know, he's a lad who come from non-league, all of a sudden is now at Roma. You know what I mean? My view is, and played at top level. So they're there. You've just got to hunt them out. They're not as many as they were, but I do think there's... I was just talking to Muzza earlier on about, just before we started, about it's very difficult now to keep players at a club for any length of time. You know, good young players get poached. because of the resources of other clubs. And that's sad. I think you lose players that way, because actually playing, and as I know it well, you know, playing that level on the way up, it's great for people. It's men's football is so much different than youth football, as we know now. And the, even the dressing room environment, learning that. He's Muzz's example of that, to go and play for England under 21, whatever it was. So, you know, he's been that man who's done that. So I just think they're there if you look at them, but you have to look at them. You know, so I'm a great, I love coaching. I'm very detailed about it. You know, I think even scouting now, it's a science. You know, a lot of people just use the science, by the way, but I think you've still got to have a pair of eyes on it. I really do. I signed one player from a video once. It worked out that badly, but it wasn't that, you know, didn't really work. It's you know, you need to see him in a game environment.
Funnily enough, one of the questions to you was, and we'll take the lid off it now, because there's all been all sorts of conjecture since you left in 2004, around about that time. And it's from Alex, and he says, have you ever been close to returning as manager since leaving in 2004?
Yes, very close on many occasions. And listen, it's not the truth of the matter will be, and it's just the fact is, any time I was close to returning, the question I asked of the chairman was, do I have control of football matters? That's all I asked in terms of who came in and out of the club. And that was something that couldn't be answered, yes. So therefore, that's a no. It was a no for me at the time, because you know it wasn't. What I'm talking about is, you know, I don't want to be coaching a team that I don't you know have faith in. You know what I mean?
It's kind of, like believing. Yeah.
You know, what I'm saying is, don't get me wrong. There's many, but. I've been at a club actually where I presented with a list where it was Moneyball. But and I said to the chairman at the time, it was a commentary actually, and I said when we changed, I said, I'll take all the young ones, I'll take all the 19-year-olds with great stats and work with them for a period, and they're not going to cost a lot of money. I'm not taking a lad, I'm just using the example, a lad from Scottish Second Division, because he's got the best stats, and putting him in, I'll tell you, if you take 26, 27-year-olds from Second Division Scotland team, you'll be at that level.
Was it about two years ago was your last time, wasn't it, when everything was ready to go?
Yes.
And you blinked on that, didn't he, Simon?
Yeah, no, listen, no, so for all the fact that, you know, it was a change of from all that time that Simon took over after the other chairman, you know, I got on well with Simon. There's no problem with him. I still get on well with him to this day. But he knew what the answer to the question was. He knew it was going to come, and he did every time. He couldn't really. And I listen. Simon likes to get involved in going out with agents and watching games and blah blah. But I don't deride him in that. That's fully. He's fully entitled to do that, because, you know, it's his club and he's running it the way he wants. That's perfect. I'm just saying, for me, I wanted to have autonomy over, you know, and I don't mean that if you're going, I understand if you're going to a Premier League club now in any role, there's huge things you don't control. But for the most part, who comes in and out of the club, unless you know you're the coach, not the manager, you have a say-so what goes on. You know, I have a mindful, a huge say. So, and I think at Oldham's level, which is far too low for me now, but that should happen. They're not Championship or League or Premier League. So it's not onerous to expect the managers to be able to pick the team.
No, I'm all right with that. And every time they said that you was going to come, and really, it's been unfair, because it's always been reported, was always down to money. But I was talking to you the other night when you agreed to come on, you told me it wasn't, and it was always about...
Never control. Listen, we never got to that really point of talking to money. So, I mean, the money was something you easily hide over. It was never about money. It was, you know, I mean, it's again the things, like this I'm saying, the club had my, when they were in difficulty, had my playoff bonus. I never received it. And they took my car off me that I didn't was supposed to be. So, you know, so in the end, you know, for that all that season, I didn't get my playoff bonus. All my car was taken off me. So my view is, we had a great affinity with Oldham, and that's why even in that difficult second season, you know, that I think there was a great belief amongst the fans that we could do something. All right, I end up leaving at Christmas, but for me, we had eight and a half thousand once at the ground. You know, it was we had a really good following because they. The people of Oldham, seeing the lads were in the pool at 7 in the morning, knew they were working hard, cared, performed at a great level. You know, they got their money's worth. When they came to watch, they had a team that was energetic, didn't always win, but didn't we tried desperately hard to win. And as a result, I think that brought people to the ground. And in the end, you know, when you look from distance now, That's very important. You've got to have a connection between the team and who you're playing with. And Oldham's a working class town who expects players to work hard, or be as gifted as John Sheridan, who, by the way, has a fantastic work ethic. If only his leg would allow him to run, he'd run all day. So it's not that he doesn't want to work; it's that he couldn't do it.
Well, a lot of fans don't realise he couldn't walk on a Sunday, John, could he? You know, he played on one leg. And I was telling someone the other day about John. He used to play in the last third and always pass to a blue shirt. And then when the other blue shirt gave the ball away, it was John running back on one leg because he knew where the ball was going.
Yeah, yeah.
It's as simple as that. It's a fact.
I think he had a... So Muzzer was a really good striker for a ball, could hit that raking 70-yard cross-field ball. He was good at that, Muzzer. Okay, but I remember John saying to him, so you don't always have to hit it. He said, you know, leave it in front of him, just you can make sure you doesn't get cut out. You know, the one that looks great but gets cut out. He never did it, he used to chip a pass and run onto it and drop at your feet. And Muzzer picked that up in his game, and not only then, you know, we all like to hit that brilliant ball that goes 7 yards in about 3 feet off the ground. But you know, what John was saying, if you hit that ball and it gets cut out, I can't, I'm not, recovery's not great for me. He said, sometimes just leave a little bit of, you know, loft on it, lift, let him run onto it. Very clever in the way he got about it, because, you know, he was a top player, and you know, and the balance of that midfield was very difficult to deal with for any team.
He played on for quite a while after you got the win, and that's the era I'm talking about, when we didn't have the same talented players in the side. So they'd give the ball away and he'd have to run back to start.
Yeah.
I think with what I'm back at the academy trying to do, I learned a lot of stuff. I had that work ethic anyway, but I learned a lot of stuff under Iain and people like John. So what we've changed, I've seen a massive change in the academy over the last year in terms of mentality. We've got, you know, we've let a lot of the second years go. We haven't kept anyone on really. A lad's got sort of a 3 extra months to prove himself, but they just quite never had that mentality that I'm after. And the group coming through in the group brought it, and I learned that mentality off when Iain was there, John Sheridan, the players you played with. You know, you're in that atmosphere in the changing room, and that's what it's all about. If you haven't got no work ethic, you've got no chance of cutting it in the game. And that's why I brought into the academy. And you know, like for us, next year it'll be a good year, but that's the mentality, the fundamentals you need.
For me, you know, we used to do little things like the academy player would train, the academy would train with us during the week. You know, we carried that. I think it's, at that time, that was not people did it. I used to watch every morning. If we were at home, I watched every single, I was always down there, I'd watch every home game or go away if I had to, go and watch the academy team. Very important. I'm not a great fan of two different areas. They're not on the same, you know. I think that's weird. You know, I know it's difficult with numbers, but you need to be in around the same, eat in the same room, and that's important. So I think there's no better place to be if you're a young footballer in a club where there's an ethos of incredibly hard work. And I think Massa's right. Without that work ethos, all the talent in the world isn't going to get you where you want to get to.
Now then, Kit Man, Brian Talbot wanted you to go full time, Martin, and give up your BT pension because he wanted to behave like the Arsenal. Is that right?
Yeah, he got me in when he came and he said, right, what do you do? And told him. And he said, well, I'm going to run Oldham like Arsenal. So I said, well, I've been at BT 30 odd years. So he said, no, you'll have to give that up. And I said, what sort of contract? So he said, it won't be a proper contract, but you'll have to give that up. I want you here all the time. So unfortunately, we had to part ways, you know. But the way we managed it before then, we managed, I mean, we're Premier League and Championship, but it worked all right. But he wanted, I don't know if he got things working like Arsenal, I'm not sure. But yeah, we had to sadly part away. So that was the end of an era, really. But you never forget it. You make friends and you stay friends. You were talking with Muzza before. I remember when Muzza first came in the dressing room, the first match. And he had the Louis Vuitton wash bag, of course. And they had these boots, carpet slippers. Don't forget, this is 2002. And he had these little tiny Nike carpet slippers. Of course, they're all like that now, aren't they? With a green muzzle.
I can't remember. I think I know what boots you're about. And that Louis Vuitton bag was probably fake anyway.
But a dressing room is, you've got to have characters, haven't you? And you've got to work, and you have strong characters. Yeah. You've got to be able to have a laugh, haven't you, really?
Yeah.
And know when not to laugh, and know when... I mean, Cato was the physio, wasn't he? And Cato helped me. Me and Cato went to the away grounds in the morning. Mick dropped us off after his breakfast. And then me and Cato set everything up. And Cato was a good lad.
Great lad.
Yeah, and a good runner.
Good physio as well. Good physio.
Yeah.
It's important, you know, you've got to have the stat standards that you have at the club. I thought, you know, he certainly upped that for me. He was involved with at Accrington for a period. We still speak quite a lot, me and Cato. So he was excellent at his job. And I thought he was very professional. He had that good balance because he did like a laugh. And, me and him, as you know, we used to run in the afternoon. So it was good fun.
Yeah. And we were working on the constraints, right? People don't realise. They don't realise. Yeah. Working under the constraints. Another thing, Roy, that we introduced the lads to was bingo. And on the coaches. And bingo, what the bloody hell are you doing, Mars? Anyway. It got quite serious because every player's got a number, haven't they? And everyone's got a nickname. So when their numbers come up, there's some fearsome crack, weren't there? No. No names, no pack drill, but number seven.
Well, I always remember from Ian's day that whilst the side was very, very fit and competitive, the bench was competitive and there was the odd fracas a time or two between opposing managers, and not much so the Swindon Town game where we got into the playoffs, the last game of the season. Again, Andy King finished up having me pinned up at side of the Coca-Cola machine in the tunnel because he'd had a bit of a fracas with our leader that day.
Can't have been me. Can't believe that.
Oh, right.
Not none of me.
Well,
4-0, was it?
Yeah, he actually locked his players in the dressing room that day, you know, Ian, and we did the press conference up on that landing that day at the top because wasn't there a bit of a jamboree going on from Oldham youth?
Yeah, there was.
There was. And disco and all sorts going on. It was very, very noisy. And he asked me to, in those days, he went and knocked on the dressing room door and asked the visiting manager to come to the press room. That's how it worked in those days. Yeah. I knocked on, and there was a hell of a noise going on inside. He opened it up, ranted and raved at me and says, I'll come when I'm ready, don't knock again. One of the directors walked past and knocked on the door, hearing the fracas, cleared off. And I'm stood there against a Coca-Cola machine when he comes roaring out, grabs hold of me, took two stewards to drag him off me, which was quite, great stuff, that. But he came up to the press conference after and he actually apologised during his press conference.
He's a good lad, Kingy. Listen,
he passed away now, wasn't he?
Yeah, he has, terrible. Yeah, he's a really nice fella. But he was passionate about his football. Like, listen, what are altercations on the side? It's really, very few and far between. Only when people talk about my team or, members, I hate that. I never do it about others. Ranting and raving, want people sent off and, he's done this, he's done that, ref. A lot of this shenanigans goes on and did it that day. We were quite happy where we were on our bench. If anything kicked off, not too much.
just we're talking about the bench and I was saying about good people, right? So this is one significant thing I remember. It'll never happen today, but it was when one of the bench, one of the subs got on, we all got some appearance money before, whatever. So if the gaffer brought on two subs or whatever, we'd get appearance money. We would actually share it out between the rest of the subs that didn't get on. So that says that's a mark of the people you're sort of working with. I don't know, that'll never happen again. But you imagine, Roy, if you don't get on the bench and me and Martin are saying, right, we got on, Roy, there's 70 quid for you. That's what we did. And that's the same. Yeah. So it just shows the type of people you are.
It comes back to when Moore left and Big Goyne got that coach and travelled down to Torex with all the staff and everything else. And they turned him back because David Brierley had sorted some form of deal out with him. And what had actually happened was, it was a strange thing because apparently, and I were talking to Tony Bugby about it just today, all the Torex staff were looking out of the window because they didn't know what the hell were going on. But during that time when wages wasn't being paid, I know that the playing staff, Mr. Dowie, sorted out the groundsmen and the ground staff.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because there's no money. And that wouldn't happen today, would it, Ian?
Yeah.
I mean, you see the facility. I went down there a few times and even went down there just afterwards once or twice. But you see the facility there. It's an incredible building, Torex. When you go there, you realise. If you're actually reading the seriousness of some of the charges in the end on it, was staggering. But listen, in the end, I just think, I think the lads all chipped in to pay the corner shot on the top, didn't they? That mark we all got, they're about 1,500 quid off, 1,200 quid they'd run a bill that hadn't been paid that we pay when we were in administration. So, because that was our little corner, the balm shop up the top, and, we sorted that out because, they're a local business who of course did well on match day, but were great with us and everyone got a balm from there and it was fantastic at the time. And we ended up doing a bit of cooking ourselves at lunchtime, the odd time, as Mark knows, on a Friday, and see what we could do. So nick down to Costco and do what we could. But Gordon, you talk about Gordon, someone ensconced in the club, you understand his feelings and you can't ownership of the club, something very, very, very special, particularly a club like Oldham. There's history that goes with it and you have to, part of that is, you have to be, if you haven't got, if you're going to do what he did and pull his money out and blah, 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 and that's a difficult thing to do, so.
Yeah. Well, I know what Gordon did before the coach trip. He rang Tesco up at Wernith there and got piles of sandwiches and drinks, loaded them on the team, but not on the team, but on the coach that they hired, piled down to Torex to try and remonstrate with the chairman at the time. It was quite amusing, but that was it. Has anybody anything else to chip in with? I may not have forgotten. I don't think so. Because I actually reckon that's an era that probably was really exciting era, Ian. Seriously, not because you sat there, it was. We've had the Jimmy Frizzle years, the Joe Royal years, they were there 12 years apiece. You were only there about 18 months. But if you ask the fans now who they want back as a manager, truthfully, they say Iain Dowie.
Yeah, well, both of them are really good managers. I look at, you know, some of the kids, you know, you think about, well, in particular, Scott Vernon, you know what I mean? I would never believe that Scott, I mean, listen, and I watched him, when he trained with us and Tony, he was, I thought he'd go on to do incredible things. Now, he's had a good career, I'm not criticising, but, you know, we had a real good interaction with the youth, you know, they came and part of it. Some of them, the lads who, I just loved the time being there. The dressing room was well run. We had good people, like, with great energy in the dressing room. We had characters, young and old. You know, it wasn't just the older players who'd run the dressing room. Of course, they were senior. You know, there was lads who had personality. And that comes from being in a man's environment a bit. You have to gain that personality. It doesn't just come to you. You have to been through hardship. And come from Carlisle. You know, they're important people to have around the place. You know what I mean? You know, the Dean Holdens, you know, Darren Sheridan, incredibly funny, you know, witty lad, had a one-liner for you. John Eyre, very, 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 taking the mick out of everyone, but very taciturn in the way he is, but good player, by the way, as well, and tough as nails. You know, and it's we had all balances. We had emotional people like Les Pogliacomi, but, you know, when I think about Scott, it's something I've always wanted to, I mean, I tried to take him to Palace with me. It never worked out. But I just thought he would be a special player. And now, I'm not saying he hasn't had a good career, yet, but I thought he was one of them players. I don't know where Muzz agrees. I just thought that's a big regret as well, why I couldn't work with him again. I thought he had something special. He had better telling them about him. Is that your food bill? Or your bill? Yeah.
That's Alan Hardy.
me and Alan got on brilliantly. Oh, Alan had, listen, he ran a very tight sheet there. We used to have good banter, went along the way the whole time, and, you know, everything. And Alan knew the price of everything and the value of nothing, I used to say. But in the end, I got on well with Alan. And by the way, his stewardship over the long, long period of club deserves a great deal of credit.
Yes, it does. One thing about
times.
If you rang the club at 7:30 in the morning, Alan would answer the phone.
Yeah, and no, I agree. Hard work, very hard work. I liked it.
Best commercial manager and best, shall we say, well, chief executive officer we've ever had. He has to be.
Just one little tale, Roy, going back to being competitive. We're competitive. I mean, John had these warm-ups before the game, and we had yoga mats, we had hurdles, we had this. It was like a moving a circus. And once John had finished doing his bit, the gaffer and David Eyres were at either side of the pitch, and they were pinging a ball to each other, and it was really competitive. And woe betide the one that didn't put it right on the mark, and you're talking like 60-yard balls, aren't you?
As he never won.
He never did. He never used his right foot.
Oh, well, listen, he's left
foot. Didn't have to.
He didn't need anything. But to be fair, I had to be on my mettle with Ezzy. He was very, very good at what he did. So, listen, and a terrific lad, as Paul said.
Top man.
Not only a good player, top player for me, but a really good person.
Yeah. Well, in winding up, I'll just say one thing that the fans always believed in, that if your team and John Arbin didn't swim at the baths before 8 o'clock and have eaten two pigeons, it didn't work.
Well, listen, we were always there. I mean, the lads, we'll testify more, but, you know, it became a thing where we eased it off a little bit. They were keen to get it back. But at the time, it was hard work. I mean, we've taken Calvin Zola to the swimming pool, let me tell it, and Clyde Wynyard to the swimming pool.
Do you remember when we had Jimmy from Portugal?
Yeah.
We got him to swim about a metre.
Yeah, you couldn't swim. Too heavy. But, I mean, listen, they just, it was something that was a shock to us all. I like swimming, but in the end we had some. I mean, Chris Killen could have been a, could have, could and should have been a triathlete. He was that good a swimmer. Les Pogliacomi is a top swimmer. You know, so there was some good. That's the trouble. There was a Mazza was a good swimmer. The swimmers in around. So it competitive in there. I mean, we do 70-80 lengths sometimes in the morning. Lot.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. We just embraced it all. The new ideas. We just thought, right, let's give it a shot and look what happens.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I think we've give the fans a great insight into the Iain Dowie years. Mm. Shall we say? Iain Dowie, 18 months, shall we say?
Yeah, well, listen, I've got to say, the last point I'd say, I had a wonderful connection with a fan. My wife and my children loved going to watch the games. You know, the players came to the team with the fans was amazing. The group of players was outstanding, ethic. We wish for a better dressing room. And I often say that, you know, my time at Palace was special, of course, but, you know, the dressing room at Oldham took a lot of beating. And the fans, I think you could see, they had a team that was working as hard as they could to try and win games. And to be fair, we nearly got there, but it's a shame we couldn't have crowned it with a thing and, you know, getting through the playoffs. But, you know, it's what it was. And something I'm very proud of, and I think Mazza and the lads, the players, should be very proud of the season because, you know, it was a special run.
Yeah, it certainly was. So, Iain, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Martin, thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Mazza, I'll be seeing you in the season.
See you soon.
I'll keep in touch.
All right.